we are entering the final stretch where we're going to see how these bills shape up. We're going to see what the negotiations the House and Senate make with each other. And all of those negotiations are done, you know, with the elephant in the room being the governor.
This has been a busy week in the legislature as both the House and the Senate wrap up their work for crossover day, the deadline for House bills to make their way to the Senate and the Senate bills to make their way to the House. Today, we'll talk about that work and what it means for Granite Staters now on The State We're In. Hello. Welcome to The State We're In. I'm Melanie Plenda. We're here to discuss Crossover Day, an important deadline in the life of a bill on its way to becoming a law. Joining us today is Anna Brown, Director of Research and Analysis for Citizens Count and host of the podcast $100 Plus Mileage, and New Hampshire Bulletin reporter Ethan DeWitt. Welcome to you both.
Great to be here, Melanie.
Glad to be on.
You know, for those who might not be familiar with it, what is the process for a bill eventually becoming a law? Can you kind of walk us through the steps?
Well, for those of you who may not be up on your I'm just a bill lyrics, a bill can start in the House or the Senate in New Hampshire. And in New Hampshire, every single bill gets a public hearing that anyone from the public can speak at. And then the committee will make a recommendation, whether they think it should pass, maybe get an amendment, if it should be killed. And then it goes for a vote before the full House or Senate. That process is repeated on the other side. So if it starts in the House, it's repeated in the Senate. If it starts in the Senate, it repeats in the House. If it passes both the House and Senate, it goes to the governor for a signature or veto, which means essentially he would kill the bill. It's his no vote, his ultimate no vote. If it does get vetoed, there's one last chance to override that veto in the legislature, and that usually happens in the fall.
So, Ethan, how does Crossover Day play into that, and what is its significance?
Sure. So Crossover Day is kind of like it's a deadline that's imposed on the process that Anna just described, and it's kind of like spring cleaning in some ways. Essentially, it's the date at which all House bills that are going to go to the Senate must be voted out, and all Senate bills that are going to go to the House must go out. And because every bill needs a vote, needs to be approved by the House and the Senate in order to go to the governor's desk, essentially any bills that survive the deadline to be moved over are the bills that the governor might be able to sign. Any bills that aren't taken up or voted down after today won't be able to move across. There are some exceptions to allow that to happen, but it becomes significantly harder to do. So the reason I look at it as sort of spring cleaning is that a lot of bills are kind of, they're brought up, but they're either controversial or they're complicated, and lawmakers don't always want to deal with them right away. And so sometimes they'll put them on the table, or they may special order them. It's another move that they can do. So they don't want to debate it this week, they'll do it next week. Well, Crossover Day is kind of like the last call for those bills. And so what makes it interesting is sort of seeing for some of the more complex bills or, which ones are going to move ahead, which ones might actually fall because they didn't actually have, the support that their sponsors originally thought, and there's also a few, maneuvers that lawmakers can do around this time to move bills onto other bills, and we can talk about that later.
Oh, wow. So Anna, so do these bills have to stay in their original state, or can they be amended after crossover?
So after crossover, once a bill moves from the House to the Senate, or the Senate to the House, anything is pretty much fair game because that public hearing process, the voting process, and amendments, changes to the bill, get to happen all over again. There's a catch, though. So if a bill passes the House, goes to the Senate, and the Senate makes amendments or changes, any of those changes have to go back to the House to be approved. They both have to pass the same version of a bill. So we definitely will see some changes to major legislation coming up. And then there will have to be those final negotiations between the House and Senate. But it's definitely, crossover day is definitely a good test of what general ideas, what legislation topics are going to be able to survive and make it to the governor's desk. And then everything else, as Ethan said, that's it. It's the last chance.
Wow. Okay. And so picking up on that, there have been a lot of interesting pieces of legislation proposed this session relating to abortion, elections, education, housing, and so much more. So Anna and then Ethan, let's talk first about some of the highlights of what's already been passed and is headed over into crossover.
Well, I think that a lot of the bills that I saw come forward, particularly in the House, that are maybe more controversial, had that controversial moment and have been voted down. So, for example, there was the notable moment when legislators proposed a constitutional amendment that would have had Granite Staters voting on whether to secede, from the United States of America, right? That's a very controversial bill, dead, right? Did not need, a constitutional amendment, first of all, needs a 3/5 vote. But also, I believe, if I remember correctly, only 13 legislators voted in favor. And there were also other dramatic bills that I'm sure we're going to talk about today related to elections and abortion and things like that, that maybe have been toned down a little bit, kind of put on pause. So that's a lot of what I sort of observed in this first half of the legislative session before crossover.
Ethan, anything you want to add to that?
Yeah, I think so. One thing I didn't mention in my introduction to Crossover Day is it's sort of an introduction. It's the final stretch of the legislative session is coming up after Crossover Day, and it really lays bare different philosophies in both chambers, different ways of tinkering with bills. And so, you know, over the years, the House and the Senate, they're vastly different in terms of the number of members they include in terms of the number of committees. And so some of the processes that might have worked on the House side, they're sort of put to the test after this. And because there are these different cultural differences with certain bills, and we can get into some of them, there's a little bit of natural tension that happens kind of when a bill heads over and, the Senate might propose something that has bipartisan support and a House committee might shred it to pieces. Each one of the bills that have not already had a hearing and have already been discussed, they're going to have another hearing in the next two months. And that's where we're going to see kind of whether the legislation is strong enough to get through both these processes. But often bills can be turned inside out in the next few weeks. What I actually reported on today, or am reporting on today, is that House Republicans are, and this is an example of this, they're using tomorrow, a few of them, to reintroduce bills that have already passed the House. There's actually a very bipartisan bill that would make a slight change to the Education Freedom Account program. It had a 17-3 vote out of the committee. And that bill, in the final hours of crossover tomorrow, is facing, I think, about 6 or 7 amendments, which include a number of controversial bills, one of which would authorize dispensing ivermectin, another would legalize possession of cannabis. And those bills have already passed the House. They're actually already are in the Senate. So it would make you wonder, why would House members try to reintroduce them and pass them again? And the reason is that they're trying to create another point of negotiation for later on in the session. And that's, again, another example of how everybody's sort of gearing up for the final 2 months, where some of, even though it's of all Republican legislature, there are vast differences and they're gonna have to bridge those. And using the amendment process tomorrow to add bills on so that there's another bill that might have the same thing that already passed and is heading to the Senate is one example of how those tensions can play out.
Wow, that's something. I mean, do we know then, Ethan, what's the immediate impact of that? How might that look different to like the average Granite Stater sort of kind of casually watching this process?
Well, I guess if you are following any particular bill, you'll notice immediately the differences. Again, it's really hard to predict, but any bill can go sideways in a flash. There are bills that you think have bipartisan support, and then they just get run, like I said, run through a shredder. One example, and I'm sure we'll talk about this later, but so cannabis, for instance, the House has been, for cannabis legalization, the House has been historically very in favor of legalization. And when it hits the Senate has historically been very skeptical of it. And so when you, if you were watching a bill, if you're a member of the public and you're watching a bill go through the House, like a marijuana legalization bill, the questions asked and the process that you saw that might have been seen collaborative in a lot of ways for that particular bill when it was going through the House. And then you would have a much different experience, in this particular example, you might have a much different experience when it hits the Senate. So again, it's really hard. It's kind of a case by case basis, but I think that the differences in philosophy, sometimes lawmakers simply just don't like the way the House or the Senate went about something. And there's no ideological difference, but there's a process difference. And they can get hung up on certain details. So if you're watching something and you care about something, you will notice.
Really interesting. It's amazing the machinations and the levers involved in all of this. And so, Anna, kind of picking up on some of these specific bills, there are several bills having to do with vaccines and mandates. So what bills have been on your radar where that's concerned?
When we first looked at the bills that were introduced in January, we noticed that probably the biggest, most common topic was vaccines. And COVID-19 vaccines in particular, but also just vaccines in general. So one of the biggest flagship pieces of legislation is HB 1455. It's sponsored by House Speaker Sherman Packard himself, and it prohibits state enforcement of federal COVID-19 vaccine or testing mandates. I think that given the spring coming, COVID receding, some of the court changes that have come down related to the vaccine mandate, that might not be such a hot topic in people's minds anymore, but that bill is still moving forward and was one of the big priorities of Republicans in the House coming into this session. There's also been changes to how employers would be allowed to grant vaccine requirement exemptions. So for example, HB 1210 would require public employers and private employers that receive public funds to give employees a right of conscience exemption from vaccine mandates. So basically someone says, I don't have to really tell you except that it goes against my conscience, and that's why I'm not going to take this vaccine. And those bills are tricky. They might run into some challenges in the Senate because this could impact federal funding for healthcare providers in particular. But that's another thing that Republicans were looking forward to in the House. On the other side in the Senate, I think it's interesting to note there's a bill, SB 319, that explicitly allows insurers to offer an incentive for COVID-19 vaccination. So while I have mentioned these other bills kind of looking to limit COVID-19 vaccine mandates, there's a little bit of a movement on the flip side as well, sort of enabling legislation saying insurers might have an interest in this. It's up to them if they want to offer people some sort of discount or other incentive. And then lastly, I wanted to mention the vaccine debate is extending beyond COVID-19 now. HB 1379 is a bill I'm watching that already passed the House. And it limits the Department of Health and Human Services' ability to add vaccine requirements for children entering schools. So, for example, state law does mention vaccines such as diphtheria, mumps, pertussis, rubella, tetanus, but the Health and Human Services Department has additional authority to require other vaccines, notably the chickenpox vaccine. And so HB 1379 walks back that authority a little bit. And so to me, it suggests that this debate about vaccines is moving beyond COVID-19. And so that's one I'm going to be watching closely.
And Ethan, so speaking of education, let's talk about bills related to education from both the House and the Senate. What are the highlights of what's making its way in to crossover?
Sure. So one of the themes, I think, with education bills in 2022 compared to 2021 is Republicans are playing defense on some of the big changes that they made in 2021. So the two biggest changes they made to education law were they passed the Education Freedom Account program. This allows families to use public money that ordinarily would follow a child to a public school district and access it through a savings account that's administered by a scholarship organization and use it towards either private school tuition, tutoring expenses, homeschooling expenses, et cetera. So this program passed last year, and Democrats have been fiercely opposed to it since it passed. And so one theme of legislation are Democratic bills that have sought to either pare that bill, that law back, or to repeal it entirely. The other attention-grabbing change that Republicans made to education law last year was the so-called divisive concepts law. It's also called the freedom from discrimination law, depending on which side you're talking to. This is the law that bars teachers from teaching certain topics in schools. Both of those passed through the budget last year. And so for a lot of the bills that we've seen, at least in recent weeks, it's been the Republicans in the House and the Senate blocking Democratic efforts to pare those back. But Republicans also have a few bills that have moved forward that would still make changes, and some of them are related to the pandemic. Anna mentioned vaccine requirements. That's one. There is a bill that would prohibit schools from requiring COVID-19 vaccinations as they can for others. There's also a bill that would prohibit school boards from requiring masks, which obviously was a flashpoint all last year. And there are a few education-related bills that deal with funding. Those are they get a little less press, but they are also important.
And Anna, some of the more controversial bills of this session have to do with abortion. So what's headed for crossover consideration?
So I think the first thing that we need to mention here is a reminder that last year's budget included a new ban on abortion after 24 weeks. And this has been controversial because it also included an ultrasound mandate for women seeking abortion. It did not include exceptions for rape, incest, or fatal fetal anomaly. So a lot of the legislation that we've seen come forward this year so far has been about repealing that 24-week ban or alternatively adding some of those exceptions, rolling back the ultrasound requirement. And Governor Sununu has also said that, in particularly related to the ultrasound requirement, he would be interested in legislation that's going to walk that back. So the Senate and the House have both passed bills that would say the ultrasound is only required if there's a substantial risk that the fetus is at least 24 weeks, which would mean it would not be required for earlier abortions. And then there's debate going on about, okay, what about rape, incest, fatal fetal anomaly? And that debate is probably going to continue long past crossover until it finally, there's a bill that makes its way to Governor Sununu's desk. Some of the more controversial bills around abortion also looked to add new restrictions. So for example, HB 1181 would allow a biological father to petition to block an abortion, and HB 1477 would ban an abortion after a fetal heartbeat is detected. Both of those bills are not moving forward at this point. So as Ethan described, there are various legislative maneuvers to resurrect bills, but it appears that the House kind of wants to or House leadership anyway, it appears is open to maybe tweaking the 24-week abortion ban, but isn't looking to move very far beyond that, with one exception. There's a bill, HB 1080, that would create a right for healthcare providers to conscientiously object to participating in providing abortion, sterilization, or artificial contraception services. So pro-choice advocates are looking at that bill and saying, okay, let's spin this out. What happens if there is a person working at a pharmacy who doesn't want to give someone their birth control pills? Whereas on the other side, conservative pro-life advocates are saying that this is a right of conscience and doctors shouldn't have to participate in abortions if they don't want to. So that was a House bill. It's going to be crossing over to the Senate, and we'll have to see how that lands in the Senate, which often takes a step back from social issues, is not as active on that social issue front as the House.
Ethan, let's turn to housing, which is a major concern in the state, and the legislature has had several proposals to ease the tight housing market. So what's likely to make it through to crossover?
It's really hard to say at this point. There have been some notable setbacks for housing, for affordable housing advocates over the past few months. And I should mention, for Governor Chris Sununu, who has made affordable housing, or housing in general, expanding housing, he's made it sort of a centerpiece of the last few years of his agenda. And he has yet to really find the traction that you would think with his popularity he'd be able to command particularly in the House. So there are one during a month ago when the governor gave his State of the State address. This is his, you know, the proverbial bully pulpit. It's as close as you get to that in New Hampshire. He's literally standing at a pulpit in front of all lawmakers in the House and the Senate. He gives this address once a year, and he gives us some priorities. He did mention a bill, Senate Bill 400, which was proposed by Senator Jeb Bradley, a Republican, the majority leader of the Republican Senate. And he forcefully spoke in favor of that. That bill would do a number of things, but it would create, it would give towns more tools to build workforce housing, new tax tools. It would also make adjustments to how zoning processes play out. And Sununu spoke forcefully to that, but when it went through the vote on the Senate floor, it got a lot less Republican support than expected. It actually passed largely with Democratic support. And so it's an indication of how this is a really slippery issue, housing. There's a recognition, I think, on both sides of the aisle of the tremendous need for it. But there, when it comes down to actually doing, taking actions that would pass laws that would, dictate, I guess, to towns what zoning provisions they should have and kind of what kinds of approvals they should be making, there's a lot less appetite. And in the House, there have been a few bills that would guarantee the rights to subdivide your property, that would, change the minimum lot requirements so as to bar towns from prohibiting anybody from, building below 10,000 square feet, et cetera. Those provisions have also not done well, and there's a strong sense of local control, and there's a strong aversion to doing anything that might seem like the state is telling local planning boards what to do. And I think as long as that culture is there, it's going to be difficult to see any significant housing bill making it forward this year.
And just to be clear, those sort of technical things that you're talking about in terms of changing the zoning rules or zoning policy and changing the setbacks and things like that, all of that has to do with if you, at least proponents of more affordable housing, believe that those are things that would increase affordable housing in different areas, correct?
Yes. The idea is kind of sort of breaking the logjam that you see in certain areas where zoning laws are, the requirement for single family homes basically precludes any significant increase in housing in any given town. And this would be a lot of these bills would be a statewide sort of top-down approach saying you can make your own zoning decisions, you can make your own planning board decisions, but we're putting some limits on that. And every time there's a limit that comes up, there tends to be opposition, especially in the House.
So, Anna, several bills having to do with elections have been proposed this session. Which of those are making their way through?
Elections was probably the most popular topic after COVID-19 and vaccines when we look back to the beginning of January. And a lot of the more dramatic proposals have already met the end of the line in the House. So, for example, there were three proposals that would have allowed ranked choice voting. Very interesting. All of those at this point look like they're not going anywhere. State Representative Tim Baxter of Seabrook, who is running for Congress in the 1st District, also proposed a forensic audit of the entire 2020 election in New Hampshire, and that was rejected. However, there are a couple changes to New Hampshire election law that are particularly looking at concerns of fraud and election security are moving forward. So, for example, in the Senate, you have SB 366, which would plan an audit of the 2022 election. So, once again, looking forward, adding more processes, for example, to audit a random selection of AccuVote vote counting machines. And that actually had bipartisan support in the Senate because the idea is if we can build up people's trust in New Hampshire's elections, as the Secretary of State and Governor have said, we have very secure elections. What else can we do to reassure people that this is the case? There's, these machines are not connected to the internet. We're using paper ballots. There's not widespread voter fraud, all those things. So SB 366, looking at setting up more audit procedures going forward to increase people's confidence. The big debate that I see emerging between the House and Senate is this concept of provisional ballots for voters who are registering on election day or who do not have ID to vote. And there were proposals in the House, there were proposals in the Senate. The Senate moved their proposal forward, but the House looks to disagree. They're not really interested in this, moving this provisional ballot concept forward. And when I say provisional ballot, it would mean that if you're showing up and you're registering on that day, you do not have ID, your ballot would be specifically marked and sort of kept in a separate pile, if you will, in a way that would allow additional verification of your identity to occur after Election Day, whether you're returning forms or the Secretary of State is doing investigation or what have you. And so that, I think, is going to end up being a little bit of a spicy disagreement between the House and Senate and whether or not New Hampshire is going to change what happens for people who don't have ID or who are registering on Election Day.
As we record this show, a few bills are still up in the air and may come down to the wire. So one of those proposals is a new law enforcement committee. So Anna and Ethan, can you tell us more about this committee and its chances? Anna, let's start with you.
So after the tragedy of George Floyd's murder at the hands of police officers, Governor Sununu formed the Commission on Law Enforcement Accountability, Community, and Transparency. And the goal was to come up with a series of recommendations to reduce police misconduct in New Hampshire and community trust, disparate policing, whatever it might be. There were a whole slew of recommendations that came forward, and a lot of those have gone forward. Some haven't. One piece of it was that there should be an independent law enforcement conduct review committee that can review allegations of police misconduct and review internal affairs investigations of officers to say, all right, what's going on here? Because right now, law enforcement misconduct is first handled at that local level by an internal affairs investigation in most cases. So the bills that have come forward, however, are looking to place this committee within the existing Police Standards and Training Council. And there's some debate about whether that really is a good idea, independent, or if it's going to be just have police policing police in a way that doesn't provide enough independent accountability. So interestingly enough, similar proposals in the House and Senate. It looks the House committee that reviewed this had unanimous support for the idea, whereas in the Senate, the vote was 3-2 in committee. So whether this ultimately goes forward, you know, I think is going to be a tricky debate that we're going to continue to follow after crossover.
Ethan, what would you like to add about that? What are your thoughts on that?
I think Anna pretty much encapsulated it. I think that this is one of the last bits of the LEAC Commission, and it's one of the trickiest bits of the LEAC Commission's recommendations. You know, some of those recommendations have moved ahead, like releasing the laurie list of officers that, you know, have been deemed untrustworthy in the past by the Department of Justice. This bill, I did some reporting on the commission that was kind of looking at this, and there were last year, there were some strong disagreements between some of the police reform advocates and civil rights advocates like the ACLU and the police unions themselves and lawmakers. So this has had a long journey, and the fact that this actually is intact as a bill is surprising if you actually go back and kind of watch what some of the debates were last year. It didn't look, too good for this bill. So to that extent, it's come a long way, but as Anna noted, it has a long way still to go. And as we've talked about, you know, this crossover process can be very brutal for legislation. And so we'll just have to see how it does first on, you know, the Senate floor and then beyond.
Another proposal that might make its way through is marijuana legalization, which we touched on a little bit. So Ethan and then Anna, what chance does that have of making its way through crossover?
This is a really interesting area. So there are a lot of different ways to obviously to legalize cannabis. Different states have tried different ways. New Hampshire has tried different ways. Right now, there are two vastly different approaches that the outcome of which I couldn't predict, but kind of how they play out is going to tell us a lot. One of them is already in the Senate. It's already crossed over. This is a clean marijuana legalization. It is essentially just legalizes possession of any amount, and it also allows for home cultivation. It doesn't allow any retail. It just starts off by legalizing possession, and so this would kind of fully remove the law enforcement component from possession. That bill is in the Senate, but that's not the bill that's getting a lot of attention. It's not the bill that's sucking all the oxygen out of the room. That bill has yet to make it across. That bill is up tomorrow, and that bill would allow a retail operation and would make the state the sole vendor of cannabis. Unlike other states that have allowed retail and kind of open it up to a market, this bill would limit it to the liquor commissions, and it would be sort of like how liquor is sold through the liquor commissions. Cannabis would be as well. The interesting thing about this bill is it's actually attracted a lot of opposition from cannabis advocates who don't like the model of the state-controlled selling and would rather the bill be killed than pass as it stands. And so there's been a lot of tension around that bill. And again, that bill's coming up tomorrow. There is a smaller one. But the other interesting thing is that the governor has long been opposed to legalization, but he has given some faint praise to the second bill that I just mentioned, the one that would allow for retail in the liquor commission. He's still in the press conference last week. He told us that he still doesn't think this is the right time, and so it seems kind of murky as to whether he would sign it or let it go without his signature or veto it. That's still very unclear. But he's sort of looked at this second bill that has attracted a bit of controversy from within the advocacy movement as the vehicle he would prefer.
And Anna, anything to add on that?
I think that it's worth noting that historically the House of Representatives has passed different marijuana legalization proposals, and then they pretty much go to die in the Senate. So I think this debate about what exactly is going to happen with this proposal to have the Liquor Commission essentially have a monopoly on marijuana sales, I think that might ultimately not persuade the Senate one way or another. We have had leaders on the Democratic side and the Republican side in the Senate indicating they're not really looking to legalize marijuana right now. So I think it's possible that this will end up just fizzling out this year again, but there's a lot more momentum this year than there has been in past years. And we are that island of prohibition, if you will, since Vermont, Maine, Massachusetts, and Canada have legalized marijuana. So if it's not this year, I think there are very high chances it will be next year.
As you both have mentioned, before any of these proposals become law, they have to get the governor's signature. So Anna and then Ethan, has he indicated what he might support and what he might veto?
We've talked about a couple of these themes. So as Ethan mentioned, the governor did indicate that he was open to the proposal to legalize marijuana through a liquor commission system. He's also brought forward SB 400, a housing bill, as something he's very interested in moving forward. That's that big package that includes a lot of different funding mechanisms and new training options and potentially infringing on local control if you are an opponent of SB 400. He's also interested in easing that ultrasound requirement that was passed as part of last year's state budget. And I think that that's probably going to be a big priority for him if he's working with legislators, because he got a lot of heat from Democrats for signing a budget that included that abortion ban and that ultrasound requirement. And so I think for him, if he can work with legislators to ease that ultrasound requirement, it's going to give him something in his pocket as the election season starts to heat up this summer.
Ethan, how about you? Anything you might, any way that you think the governor might surprise us with a veto or an approval of something?
I think there are always surprise vetoes. I think this governor chooses carefully when he decides to weigh in on legislation. He has, in all of his past terms, whether under Democratic or Republican legislatures, he will often, if reporters ask him, say he hasn't taken a close enough look or he doesn't, he wants to let the process play out, unless he decides he wants to get ahead of a bill, in which case he will come out. So it really is kind of it's a discretionary move that he makes, and the only legislation that he's directly vowed to veto that I'm aware of, there might be others, is the House, the redistricting map for the congressional districts, and he has been very clear about that. And for the other elements, the merit that we talked about, the cannabis legalization, he has suggested he's open to it, but then he has sort of walked that back, and then he said, you know, I like this approach, but I don't know if this is the time now. That's typically his style if he's going to talk about legislation to the press. And again, this is, to go back to the very beginning of this conversation, this is why crossover day is important, because we are entering the final stretch where we're going to see how these bills shape up. We're going to see what the negotiations the House and Senate make with each other. And all of those negotiations are done, you know, with the elephant in the room being the governor. And so we'll see how those final arrangements are made and whether they're tailored to the governor at all, and whether he makes more statements.
Anna Brown, Director of Research and Analysis for Citizens Count and host of the podcast $100 Plus Mileage, and New Hampshire Bulletin reporter Ethan DeWitt, thank you both so much for being here.
Thank you, Melanie.
Thanks for having us.
Conversation continues online. What proposals are you following through the state legislature? We'd love to hear from you. Visit our Facebook page at collaborativenh.org and use the hashtag NHCrossover. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next time on The State We're In.